C'est
Oui,
bon.
très bien,
Ok.
déjà.
Ok, donc oui, je vais commencer. This is a joint work with a lot of colleagues and a lot of friends, in particular Javier Fernández, Luis Ramírez, Ignacio Colominas, and Fermín Navarrina from the Group of Numerical Methods in Engineering from the University of A Coruña. And also Sofiane Keladi, Jean-Camille Chaussin, Michael Deligan, Abdelkader Krimi, Panagiotis Toutsanis, from other different universities, Artemetier, bien sûr, Sorbonne University, and Cranfield University. Well, very briefly, I'm going to tell you the work that we are developing in the last months in our group, which is devoted to the development of a numerical method for the implicit large eddy simulation of compressible turbulent flows. So this is the outline of my presentation. First, I'm going to introduce the problem and implicit large eddy simulations. And then I'm going to go further in the two basic stones, fundamental stones of the method, which are the ADA method and the a posteriori detection. Then I'm going to show you some numerical examples. And finally, if I have time, I will show you very briefly the application of the algorithm to the meshless method to the SPH schemes. Finally, the conclusions. So, as all of you know, turbulent compressible flows have more complex physics than incompressible ones. Incompressible turbulence is based on the transference of vortical energy, mainly. However, compressible turbulent fluctuations can be seen as a combination of three fundamental physical modes: the vortical modes, as in incompressible turbulence, but also acoustic and entropy modes. In simulation of turbulence, numerical simulation of turbulence, the subgrid scale model, SGS models, are the most used methodology to address this problem. The problem is that most of the subgrid scale model used for the simulation of turbulent compressible flows are based on models which were developed for incompressible flows. So in general, they are not very accurate models when we deal with compressible turbulence. Here we present a numerical method which is based on two fundamental points, the ADA method and the a posteriori detection. The ADA method locally adapts the numerical dissipation of the method, trying to mimic the physics of the flow, as I will try to show you in the following minutes. However, as we are modifying the numerical viscosity of the method, in compressible flows, we have to include a mechanism to stabilize the scheme because we can suddenly find discontinuities, waves, contact discontinuities in the flow. And if we are reducing the viscosity of the numerical method, we can have the stability problems. And this is the job of the a posteriori detection. In order to understand the approach that we are proposing, I'm going to very briefly introduce the energy cascade process. This is in incompressible turbulence, the main mechanism for the transference of energy is explained with this idea, with the idea of the energy cascade. It requires that the energy transfer to be local in scale. That is, only the interactions are only between fluctuations of nearly the same size. The largest motions, here I'm going to speak of scales meaning with the same meaning as eddies. For example, if I speak about large scales, I'm referring to large eddies, large vortices. So the largest motions of flow, the largest eddies of turbulence, contains most of the kinetic energy, whereas the smallest eddies here in the spectrum, this is the spectrum of energy, this is the energy, and here you can see the wave number, So the small steadies are here, and the large steadies are in this part of the graph. So most of the kinetic energy is on the largest steadies of the flow, and the small steadies are here and they're responsible for the viscous dissipation of the turbulent kinetic energy. Then the idea is as follows. The largest vortices containing most of the energy breaking smaller ones, and this breaking procedure is due to inertial fluctuations. So the viscosity at this moment plays no role at all. So this breaking procedure continues until the viscosity started to being important. So when the viscous forces are comparable to the inertial ones, to the inertial forces, the size of the vortices is small enough and the Reynolds number is around unity in this scale. This scale is called the Kolmogorov scale. At this moment, when the dissipative forces are important, they compare with the inertial ones, the energy is dissipated by viscous forces and the cascade process ends, arrives to its end. So a numerical method, which is designed for the simulation of turbulent flows, has to be able to reproduce this phenomena, which is the basis of the dynamic process. So in case of compressible flows, this is not the only mechanism for the transfer of energy, but and this complicates even more the development of models for this physics. So if we consider a computational grid, for example this one, and some vortices from different sizes, these are the largest vortices, and here we see smaller vortices. So if the vortex is large enough, for example this one, our computational grid with our numerical method is able to capture it properly, and the dynamics of the flow are well captured by the numerical scheme and the grid. So we call this we say that the flow is locally well resolved. So these are the well solved vortices. We can reproduce the dynamics of the vortex with our discretization of the equations. So the problems arise when the vortex size is smaller than the grid size. In this case, we cannot reproduce the dynamics of the flow, and we have a problem because in the general case, the size of the vortex lies in some point here in the energy cascade. So we are still far of the dissipative of the Kolmogorov scale, where the dissipation is acting, and in the equations, in the physical equations, there are no any mechanism to dissipate this energy. So if our numerical method has no any intrinsic dissipation to dissipate this energy, we are going to suffer a piling up of energy, and we are going to arrive to a crash of the computations, or at least to a non-physical solution. So the idea is that the numerical method has to be able to introduce the right dissipation in the right scale, which mimic this decay rate, which is the Kolmogorov's law. Okay, when we have this vortex which is smaller than the grid space, we say that we have under-resolved flow. The typical approach to solve that is to use subgrid scale models. So the subgrid scale models usually are dissipative models which introduce the dissipation that we need to mimic this phenomena. So the problem is arises when we face two fundamental questions. So the first one is that if we accept that the Navier-Stokes equations model the dynamic behavior of the flow, should we change the equations depending on the laminar or turbulent regime? So this is not a very naive question, because Most of Rand's model, for example, the typical Fourier's approach to solve the turbulent flows, we are changing the equations. They are not the Navier-Stokes anymore equations anymore. So is it a right approach? This is the first question. And the second question is, can turbulence model be considered independently of the numerical method? We have seen that the turbulence that we have introduced, the viscous dissipation that we need some dissipations introduced to stabilize the scheme, and we need that the dissipation follows, mimics the Kolmogorov's law. So most of the numerical method, or at least in general, the numerical methods are going to introduce some kind of viscosity. So is it reasonable to consider independently the turbulence model from the numerical method? This was the common approach in turbulence, but I think that is not the right approach to address these problems, because in one way or another, we have to evaluate the global viscosity that we are introducing in the numerical scheme. So, since the numerical method must be designed to mimic the physics to solve all the energy modes, we proposed an implicit subgrid scale model, which is based on the adaption of the intrinsic viscosity of the numerical scheme. The main advantage of this approach is that it has a general applicability. So we can use the proposed method to simulate both laminar and transitional flows. And even more important is that it will be applicable to complex flows, multiphase flows, non-Newtonian flows, where no turbulence model even exists at this moment. So I think this is a powerful and a promising approach that we have to develop even more, but with these strong capabilities. So the basic idea of the approach is to locally detect if the flow is under-resolved or not. If it is under-resolved, that is, if we have a small vortex size, which are smaller than our grid size, the numerical method going to increase its dissipation to avoid the piling up of energy. If it is not, the numerical method decides that he has enough dissipation, and he tries to adjust decreasing the dissipation to follow the Kolmogorov's law. One important point is that from the numerical point of view, we have unresolved flow. If we have some scales that are not well captured by our numerical grid or numerical method, we are going to see high frequencies in the solution, and this is a point that we will use to detect where the flow is under-resolved or not. So the idea is that this is an automatic procedure to obtain the best possible solution for the chosen numerical method on a given grid. At the end, it is a numerics-based approach, because it's based on the highest frequencies to detect where we need to introduce dissipation, but it will be physically calibrated in order to reproduce the physics of the flow. So very briefly, because I don't want to go further in this, we use moving least squares as a filter procedure. Very briefly, the idea is that moving least square as a way to reconstruct a function at a point using a weighted least squares approximation. And the idea is that this approximation is going to minimize error functional based on the error of the approximation. And the important point here is that it depends on a kernel, which is a smoothing function, and a parameter to define this kernel. I'm going to skip this. The important point is that approximation can be written in this way. in this way, the where n are the moving least square shape functions, which depends on the number of neighbors, depends on the kernel, and depends on the polynomial basis. So when we have these moving least squares functions, we have to use a kernel, as I already said. And this is the kernel that we are using here. This is an exponential type kernel. And we see that depending on this parameter kappa, the shape of the kernel is going to change. When the shape of the kernel changes, the numerical properties of the scheme are going to change, and also the numerical properties of the filter that we are using. So if we use moving least squares approximation as a filter, what we do is the following. This we have our solution. This is the solution at a point of a grid, uj. If we make a reconstruction of moving least squares, we obtain a filter solution. Depending on the parameter that we use for the construction of the shape functions, we're going to have this filter, this filter, or this filter. This is the transfer function of the filter. So all these filters are low pass filters with different frequency of cutting frequency. So we can construct different filters, different with a different width, different cutting frequency, but only by varying this parameter. So this is a point that we will use in the ADIA approximation. The ADIA method, ADIA stands for automatic dissipation adjustment, and this method was recently developed as an implicit subgrid scale model and was applied to the computation of log mag flows, where at the end to incompressible flows. So the main idea is based on the local energy ratio, which was introduced by Tanticul and Domaraski in this paper in 2010. And the main idea of the approach is to use a multiplicative coefficient epsilon, which is going to vary between 0 and 1, and it is said to multiply the dissipation part of a numerical flux of a Riemann solver. This is maybe very technical, but you are going to see that it is not very difficult to understand. So the idea is to extend the range of application of this approximation to all the range of Mach number flows. So, for example, a typical Riemann solver that we use in finite volumes is the rho flux, rho numerical flux, which usually is written as a central flux. Here, if you are not used to Riemann solver, in a Riemann solver we have a discontinuity, and we have an state, a left state, and a right state. So this stands for the flux evaluated with the value of the left state, and the other with the state with the right state. So we have a central flux, and this in red is the dissipation part. This is the dissipation that the numerical flux is adding to stabilize. So we introduce the epsilon here in the dissipation part with a value that varies between 0 and 1. When epsilon is 0, we recover a central flux. When epsilon equals to 1, we recover the original rho flux. So the problem is how to decide the value of epsilon. I'm going to show you also the application of this methodology to another scheme, to the WINO5 scheme based on finite difference, to see the applicability, the general applicability of the algorithm. So in the WINO, in finite difference, we consider the Lax-Friedrich flux usually, and it is not obvious, but we can write this flux in this way. A central part and a dissipation part. This is a more complex and a non-usual way of writing the WINO flux, but it is possible to do that for any WINO method. And here we use the right and left eigenvector matrices because we are using a characteristic approach. But the important point for following the presentation is that we are going to introduce here the epsilon parameter in the dissipation part. The question is the same again, how to decide the value of epsilon. So we use the energy ratio. The energy ratio, the original energy ratio introduced by Domaraski is this quotient here, this fraction here. So here we have the value of the velocity in one cell, and this is the value of the velocity in the same cell, but with a filter velocity. And here we have the filter velocity with a different filter. So the main idea is what we have here is the high frequency, is a ratio of the high frequency content of the solution at a given point. So if we have a high energy ratio, we have a high energy content, high frequency content on the solution. And from the numerical point of view, we can think that we have under-resolved flows at this part of the grid. So, in order to use this for a compressible flow, we use the following modification. Instead of using the velocity, we use the momentum, but the idea is the same. So here we use the moving least squares with a kappa parameter of 4 and kappa parameter of 3, and we have a value of the energy ratio for our problem. So in order to adjust the value of epsilon, we have to assign a value of the energy ratio, a threshold to know, okay, from this value of the energy ratio, I have unresolved flow, and for another value, I have a well-resolved flow. This is where the calibration comes to arise. We need to calibrate the method because it depends on the filter that we use. It also depends on the numerical method that we are using. So we have to calibrate it, and we use a typical test case, which is the Taylor-Green vortex that I will show you later, to calibrate the model. So here what we can see is that if the energy ratio is less than 0.5, we consider that there is no under-resolved flow, that all the flow is well solved, and we can reduce the viscosity. So we increase the value of epsilon. When the energy ratio is greater than 0.55, we consider that this value of epsilon, the energy ratio is high. There is an amount of high frequency content of the solution which is high, and we need to increase the dissipation by increasing the value of epsilon. This phi parameter is to adjust the value of epsilon continuously and gradually. So these values are different from the original work of Lia Tsubokura because we are using another method and we have to calibrate it differently. So for the case of the Guino 5, we see that we have different values here because it's a different numerical method. But the calibration procedure is the same. So in order to keep the conservative character of the numerical scheme, well, we have to ensure that at the interfaces we have a single value of epsilon. We have a value of epsilon from one cell, we have a value of epsilon from a neighboring cell, and at the interface we take the maximum value between the two. This is in order to ensure the robustness of the numerical scheme. So this is the automatic dissipation adjustment method. We see that we are reducing and increasing the dissipation depending on the energy content of the solution. But the problem is that if we have a compressible flow, in some point, suddenly we can find a discontinuity in the solution, and maybe in this moment, at this point, the viscosity of the numerical method is not enough to stabilize the computation near shock. So we need a methodology to ensure the stability of the numerical approach, and this is why we use the a posteriori paradigm that I'm going to explain you now. So in typical classical approaches for finite volumes, or for in general for any method, what we have here is at a given time step we have a solution. Then we use our numerical method or finite volume solver to obtain the solution at the following time step. The usual approach is to, when we're dealing with compressible flows, is to make a guess of where are we going to face to have problems in the next time step. In our guess, we introduce dissipation, or we use a slope limitation. But this is a guess, and as it is a guess, we can fail, and sometimes we can get a crashing in the solution. And this is our problem of a high order method, so that they have reduced dissipation. And if you have shocks or you have discontinuities in the solution, well, it is they are not TVD and they are not stable. So what we propose here is to use the a posteriori approach. The a posteriori approach is, the idea is very simple, but it is very powerful also. So if we start at a given time step, so the what we do is to use our the numerical method, the most accurate numerical method that we can use. For example, if we have finite volumes, we can use a fifth order, sixth order finite volume approach without any slope limitation, without any artificial viscosity. And we go to time n plus one. This we obtain what we call a candidate solution, because it's the solution that we are trying at this moment, but it is possible that the solution is not valid, because we can obtain not a numbers, we can obtain negative densities, the typical problems that lead the computation to crash. But what we do now is, okay, I have this solution at this time n plus one, and I'm going to check if it is admissible or not. So I'm going to check if the candidate solution is an admissible solution. What we do is to apply some kind of detectors that I'm going to show you now to decide if they are physical and if they have slow oscillations. If it's okay, everything is okay, I consider that the candidate solution is the final solution. And if it is not, I decrement, I detect the points, the exact points where I'm going to have problems, and I decrement the order of the numerical scheme, which all of you know, that this is going to increase the dissipation. And at the end, I need a basic scheme, that in this case is the first order finite volumes, that it will be, it is always stable. So, at the end of the mood loop, I'm going to obtain a solution, because if with all this in all this loop I always obtain a bad solution at a given point, in the last iteration of the mood loop I'm going to use a first order scheme at this point, which always give an admissible solution. So you see that the difference is that here I'm not guessing at all. I'm doing an a posteriori detection, because I'm seeing what is my solution, and I see where my problems are, and where I need to act to correct. So the main idea is shown in the in this slide. I have a solution at given time, and I compute the following time step with a higher order reconstruction. So I obtain the blue solution. The first thing that I have to ask is it physically admissible? Okay, this is done with the physically admissible detection. So this is only to check if I have not a numbers, if I have the positive densities, positive pressures, if I haven't numbers in my solution, and I have positive densities and positive pressures, then my solution is at least physically admissible. So this following question that I have to ask is if I have numerical oscillations. This is what I do with the discrete maximum principle. The main idea is to check if I'm creating new streama in my solution. This is V is a set of points. It depends on the approach that we have. It can be the neighboring points or a greater stencil. You can use the same points that you use for your usual slope limiters. In this paper of Panagiotis, he has studied the influence of this set of points in different limiting techniques, it's not very. You can use whatever you are used to work with here. So here we use this set as the stencil that we use in the moving squares approximations. So once we detect that here, for example, we have created a new maximum. Here we see that this maximum for this solution is new, so it is not valid. So the following thing that we have to check is, can the oscillation be neglected? So sometimes in our solution, due to the truncation of real number representation, we can have very small fluctuations that the discrete maximum principle is going to detect as a shock, as a oscillation, and it's really not important. So we are using this plateau detector to relax the detection of the DMP detector. So once in this case, we consider that this solution this oscillation cannot be neglected. So we recompute the marked cell, the cell E in this point here, with a lower order reconstruction, for example, the first order one, and we obtain a lower order reconstruction at time n plus one. So in practice, instead of using the DMP plus plateau detector, we use a relaxed version of the DMP, which was introduced by Michael Dumser and Raphael Loubert in 2014. This is easier to code and it works fine. So if one cell does not verify the PAD criteria, we mark it and we recompute it with a first order scheme and a value of epsilon equals to one. So this is the first order, the original first order scheme. In the case of Wino, Wino approach, we use Wino 5 with epsilon equals to 1. But if the cells does not verify the NID criteria, the numerical admissible detection criteria, we recompute it with a first order scheme, but we can try to use a value of epsilon different to 1, because maybe with increasing a little bit the value of epsilon, or keeping the value of epsilon given by the ADA method is enough if we increase the dissipation by reducing the order. So here we can, I'm not going to enter here because there are several options. And one possibility, for example, is to keep the value of epsilon given by the ADA method and perform an additional step of the mood loop. For example, we have epsilon equals to 0.5, with and we are trying with first order. If it works, okay. If it doesn't work, we try again with first order with epsilon equals to 1. This is the approach that we recommend. Another possibility is to define a minimum value of epsilon, depending on the strength of the shock. And this was our original approach. We can give you the reference later if you want to see it deeper. But here I'm going to skip this part because it's somewhat technical and maybe it's not important here. So the main idea is the following. We are at time, given time n, we use our finite volume solver with our highest, with a more accurate scheme, and with the values given by the ADIA method, values of epsilon. We obtain our candidate solution, and then if the physical admissible detection detects that it is not admissible, we obtain, we recompute this point, this cell, with epsilon equals 1 and first order. If it is good, we check for the oscillations. If there are acceptable oscillations, we go to n plus 1. And if it is not, we recompute with first order or second order, if we are third order. It depends on the mood of the cascade of methods that we have decided. And with a value of epsilon that, it depends. We can try with the same value to define an epsilon minimum for the shocks. Well, but the idea is that we have to recompute with a little more dissipation. At the end, if it never works, we try with epsilon equals to 1, first order, and we arrive to the time n plus 1 solution. From the Win of 5 approach is the same idea, but the only thing is that we have an invalid solution. We try with the Win of 5 with epsilon equals to 1. It is also possible to use an additional step in the mood loop by using Win of 3rd, Win of 3, or another scheme. A more dissipative scheme, but for the sake of simplicity, we use here the simpler algorithm, which is this one. Well, then numerical examples. I'm going to start with the invested Taylor Green vortex because it is the simplest model for the analysis of the nonlinear transfer of kinetic energy among the different scales of a flow. Even it is a very simple case, it contains several key physical processes in turbulence. We are going to solve the inviscid version of this test case because it is equivalent to an infinite Reynolds case, which is a heavily under-resolved simulation because we are going to use a 64 cubic grid because in this case leads to a very, very under-resolved simulation. When we arrive at a time, a time of 9 or 10, more or less, we are already a lot of small under-resolved scales. And we have to recover the Kolmogorov's law of the decay of energy. Okay, so this is the initial condition. And here we show the kinetic energy evolution for different schemes. So the first thing we see is that at the beginning, ideally, we always have to keep this one kinetic energy of 1 because there is no viscosity. And at the end, we should keep the viscosity constant, the kinetic energy constant. The problem is that once we arrive to have a smaller scale, subgrid scales in the flow, we have to dissipate these scales because if we don't do that, there are no mechanisms to dissipate this energy, and the computations are going to crash. So the usual thing is that for this grid of say 64 cubic elements, at time 5, we already need to introduce dissipation. Once we introduce dissipation, we started to have a viscous problem, and then we have to obtain the Kolmogorov's law of the decay. So this is the result obtained by the TINO 8 model, numerical method, which is one of the most accurate finite difference methods for turbulence simulations. Here we have an spectral finite difference approximation. This is a residual distribution scheme with a third order. This is a second order finite volume scheme. This is the original WINO 5. And the blue line is what we have obtained using our approach with a third order finite volume method. Compared with the other third order method here, we see the great gain of accuracy that we have obtained. Here we have the entropy evolution, and this is the same pattern. The entropy is a measure of the force of the vortices, of the intensity of the vortex that we have here. If we have a lot of dissipation, we have less entropy because our vortex or the flow motions are more dissipated. So the most important picture is here. Here we see the energy spectrum for different times. Here we have the energy, and here we have the wave number. So at the of a time of 10, we have to recover this black dashed line, which is the Kolmogorov's law. In red, we have what we have obtained using the third order finite volume method without any model of turbulence, without the ADA method, without any subgrid scale model. We see that the numerical method is stable, we obtain a solution, but it is not very physical in the sense that we don't the viscosity is introduced in the numerical method in any scale without following the Kolmogorov's law. The thick blue line is what we have obtained with the same numerical method once we use the approach that I'm proposing. So here we see that we obtain the right Kolmogorov's law even for the even until the cut frequency. Here this is if we have 64 points of the grid in each direction, we only can solve until 32 wave number, no? in the analysis of the spectrum. So until the last point we can solve, we obtain a very accurate representation of the decay. This is the obtained result for the WINO 5. This is the spectrum for the WINO 5, and this is the spectrum that we obtain for with our approach. We see that we have also a very huge increase of accuracy. Here we see structures, entropy contours, and in blue we see where the value of epsilon is zero, that is where we have a central scheme, and in red we see that we have the points where we have epsilon equals to one. You see that there are very small points which requires such amount of viscosity. The same for the value of t equals to 5. And here we see the order of the scheme. Red is the third order scheme. And in yellow, we obtain the points where the scheme is reduced to first order. We see that there is not a lot of points. There are not a lot of points with this which is reduced order. We see the same problem, but with viscosity, so which is a full decay problem. Very briefly, we see that the decay of energy for 32 and 64. When we refine, we go to until the reference, which is a DNS, the direct numerical simulation. Compared with another methods in the literature, we see that we are very close to the reference, even with the coarser grid. These are the density fluctuations, the same pattern we see as we refine, we are closing to the reference. The normalized temperature fluctuations. This is important because there is one paper from Moin which shows that not all the numerical methods developed for implicit large eddy simulations are able to reproduce the thermodynamical variables. In this case, the normalized temperature fluctuations are perfectly captured for the scheme. This is the three-dimensional spectrum. Here, for the original scheme, using our approach, we see that we're following very closely the reference spectrum. If we refine, we obtain the good solution. And a very important point here is the evolution of the numerical viscosity. What we expect at the beginning is that this line, the blue one, is always under the purple line because it's the reduced dissipation scheme. But we see that at this point, our scheme is more dissipative than the original one. And why is this? The answer is here. If we analyze this decay of energy, we see that the basic scheme is a third order scheme, which is a low dissipation scheme, and it has not enough dissipation to reproduce the Kolmogorov's decay. So we need to even decrease the order of the scheme in order to follow close to improve the decayment in this case. You see that here the line in blue has a steeper decayment of the decay of energy. This is more viscosity because it is needed, because the basic numerical method is not able to introduce the right amount of this viscosity, and this is a problem which is this is a big problem of high order methods, because you have very low dissipative schemes, and when you try to use that to simulate turbulent flows in very coarse grid, you have not enough dissipation to reproduce the physics, and with our approach we are able to do that. So here, are you listening to me? Because I cannot see you. Are you listening to me?
Well, yes.
Okay. So here we see the same that previous. I'm going to skip this in order to be brief. So this is another case with the strongest shock, and using in this case the Wien-5 approach. And we see that using the methodology, this is the Wien-5 approach, very, very dissipative. With our method, we obtain almost the DNS, and we are comparable to some of the methods that are currently used for this, the state-of-the-art methods for this simulation, which are the STAN, the ADPD. This is the normalized temperature fluctuations. Again, we obtain a very good result here, the dilatation and the entropy. We see that our method is the one which gives the bigger entropy, so the more intense the vortex are. And finally, the instantaneous spectrum, which are really very good. Compare the red line with the blue one and with the reference one. So we are able to reproduce the physics of the flows. This is another test for strong shocks, the Mach 3D wind number with a step. This is the solution without our approach, and with our approach we are able to capture here this Kelvin-Helmholtz instability, which are not captured in the usual methods here. Okay, and finally, to finish, I'm going to show you the application to SPH. In the important point here, there are no Riemann solvers, but the dissipation is introduced in this part here. This part is the added dissipation, so we introduce here the epsilon value. So we test this approximation for the 2D Taylor Green vortex. This is what we obtain here. This is a Lagrangian method. This is a meshless method. They are particles moving. So we obtain here, we see some vortex, but they are quite dissipated. This is a typical problem of SPH. We see here the value of the dissipation. In this case, all the particles are with a value of epsilon equals to 1 because it's the original approximation. So if we compare now with our approach, we see a different dynamics, a very smaller structure on the grid. We see the intensity of the vorticity is bigger in this case. We see here how the method is able to capture the physics of the flow. We see here how the viscosity is acting where it is needed. And at the end, we arrive with the two vortex configuration, which is the typical final state of this approach. And we see here that there is a lot of particles with no viscosity at all. Okay. So this is the spectrum that we obtain for different number of particles. We see that even for a very, very coarse discretization, we obtain the expected decay rate. Here, the results, if we compare with other methods with other SPH methods, we see that they have a lot of dissipation. We see here, and with our methodology, we are able to follow closely the theoretical line. This is the energy decay. The ideal decay is 1, is here. The ideal decayment is here without the decay. And then, we see that here, this is the reference, this is not the reference, sorry. This is the solution with 40,000 particles, and then what we obtain with 10,000 particles and the same discretization for other SPH schemes. And we see that there is a lot of difference between our approach and the other in the literature. So to end, I have presented a new methodology for implicit large eddy simulation computations using adaptive numerical dissipation. It is based on the use of the energy ratio, which adjusts the amount of dissipation introduced by the numerical method. The stability of the numerical scheme is ensured by the using of the a posteriori paradigm. And the formulation is promising and obtains accurate and very good results. And we need more research for assess the behavior of the method in presence of walls and in case of very strong shocks. But we are optimistic about that. If you want to check some reference, we have published the first one this year in Computers and Fluids, and we have submitted these two from the SPH and from the WINO 5 approach. So this is all that I wanted to show you. Thank you very much for your attention.